Hello there! Welcome to this series on the basics of After Effects. In this video, we're going to be covering how to get started on your first project with compositions, transform properties, and basic keyframing. So when you first open After Effects, your screen should look something like this. And over on the left, we have the Project tab. And this is where all your files are stored. So any images, audio, and any other media or footage that you might be using in your project sit here. There are a couple ways you can import files into After Effects. You can go up to the File tab here and go to File, Import File, and choose what you want. Or you can just double click into this empty space and you can pick the files that you like. So I'm going to grab these three and then import them in. So now that we've imported some files to work with, we can start by making a composition. There are a couple of different ways you can make a composition. Obviously, right in front of us, there's a new composition button. But instead of this one, I'm actually going to go to the button at the bottom of the project tab right here and click Create a New Composition. This is going to open up our composition settings where we have our name, our dimensions, our frame rate, our duration, and the background color. So I'm going to name our composition Tutorial. Typically, I do 1920 by 1080 with a frame rate of 30. And once you're ready, you can just hit the OK button. You can also make a new composition by going straight to Composition, New Composition, and you'll see that the shortcut for this is also Control-N. Another way you can make a composition is by directly dragging a file onto the Create Composition button. So when you do this, it'll make a composition based on the setting of the footage. So for example, if I take our psokenobackground.png file and I drag it straight on top of this, it will create a composition with the same name and dimensions as the image. So if we want to look at the settings from here, we can go to Composition, Composition Settings, and we'll see that our image is 1000 by 1000 pixels, and our composition is also 1000 by 1000. You can also open up your composition settings at any point using the shortcut Control-K. Typically, I like to start my projects by dragging the audio file on top of the composition button, as it'll make a composition the same length as the audio, which is pretty convenient, and then I adjust the dimensions and frame rate accordingly. So we're going to head back to our tutorial composition, and we're going to start adding footage to our composition. You can add footage by directly dragging it into the composition preview like this, and it will be placed at the position that you drop it at. You can also drag it directly into the timeline down here. If you drop it on the left, it's going to make it the same length as the composition, or you can drop it at a specific time point, like 15 seconds, and the file will start there. So I'm just going to drop our file in. You'll also notice that in other video editing programs, typically you'll find that you have a timeline and then you can slot footage in that timeline according to when you want that footage to be visible. So we might have like one MP4 file from like 0 to 15 seconds, and right next to it we'll have another one that we want to use, and then another one all in the same bar. You'll notice that in After Effects, each layer here is its own file. So every time you add a new file that exists as its own layer, you're never going to have things right next to each other in the timeline. So for example, if I drag our other image in here, you'll see that it automatically makes a new layer for that image. So I'm just going to delete this here. Now we're going to take a look at transform properties. If you hit this arrow to the left of the layer name, it's going to open up a tab called transform. And if we open up this tab as well, we're going to see five properties. Anchor point, position, scale, rotation, and opacity. It's quite self-explanatory, most of them are, but the anchor point is the point at which the image is going to rotate and scale around. So if we click on our image here, we're going to notice there's this circle in the middle, and this circle is our anchor point. So you can change any of these values by clicking and dragging to the left or right, or you can manually type a number in. So if I rotate our image here, we're going to see that the image is rotating using this as its center point. If I scale, it's also going to grow using this as the center. You can move the anchor point around by adjusting the values in the anchor point parameter here. As you'll notice, it basically looks like you're moving the position of the image. You'll see that this is actually different from position, because if you move the position, the point is going to move along with it. So typically, I like to move the anchor point by using the anchor point tool. So if we go to the top here, there is a tool called the anchor point tool. The shortcut for this is Y, so I'm just going to click here, or you can click Y to open it up, and you can just directly click on the anchor point and move it to where you'd like. And then we can go back to our regular selection tool by clicking V or clicking this button up in the top corner. So I'm going to move the anchor point up to the forehead and go back to our selection tool. And now you see that if I rotate, it's going to rotate using the forehead as its center point. You can also adjust the position of the layer by just dragging it around here. And same with the scale, we can pull these corners. Although in the case of scale, it will distort the image. So if you want the image to not be distorted, you're going to have to hold shift while dragging it. You can also adjust the scale down here, and you'll notice that there is this chain here. If you uncheck the chain, you'll be able to distort the image and adjust the X and Y scale accordingly. And if we check this back here, it'll maintain this ratio. Okay, so I'm going to set our image back to normal. So you'll be using these transform properties quite a lot, so I highly recommend memorizing the hotkeys for them. And luckily, they're quite intuitive. So if you click on the layer and then you hit A, it'll pull up just the anchor point information. For position, you're going to hit P. For scale, you're going to hit S. For rotation, you're going to hit R. And for opacity, unfortunately, it's actually T for transparency and not O, as that'll be a hotkey for something else. I'm going to post a shortcut cheat sheet in the description with the hotkeys covered in each video so that you can reference them at any point. So no worries at all if you don't have them memorized or you feel like I'm throwing a lot of info at you at once. So next, we're going to move into simple keyframing. Keyframes represent the state of a property at a specific point in time. So let's say I want to make my character slide onto the screen. We're going to need to animate the position of the character. So I'm going to click on the layer, hit the P button to open up the position properties. And to the left of the word position, you'll see that there is a little stopwatch button here. And if you click this button, it'll make a keyframe and tell the program, hey, I want to animate this property of the layer. And if you click it again, it'll remove all the keyframes. So we're just going to click this. And you can zoom into your timeline here using these triangle buttons at the bottom. So I'm just going to zoom in a little bit closer here. And let's say I want the character to start off on the bottom of the screen and then slowly slide up over 4 seconds. I'll start by moving the position down. So I'm just going to move the character off the screen. And then I'm going to go to 4 seconds. You can just drag this or directly click on 4 seconds. And then I'm going to be moving it back up. If I change the position property at a time point where there's no keyframe, a keyframe will automatically be generated. You can also manually make a keyframe at the current time point. So if I jump to 2 seconds and click the keyframe button, it'll make a keyframe for me here, and I can adjust this as I'd like. So you can jump between keyframes using these arrow buttons as well. So this will jump you to the previous keyframe, and this will jump you to the next one. So now you're going to notice that there is a thin green bar in the timeline here. In After Effects, you have to pre-render your video before you view it. It can't instantly play like other programs. So this bar shows us which parts of the video have been pre-rendered and are ready for viewing. Since this is quite simple, the whole thing is green right now. Let's say I nudge this a little bit more, we notice that it's going to go back to gray, and it needs to be pre-rendered again. So now we're going to take a look at preview settings. Your preview settings might be over here, or if they're not here like me, go to Window and go to Preview. So we're just going to open up, drag these preview settings over here to take a look at them. So typically, I check this cache before playback box and this if caching play cache frames box. And basically what this does is that when I hit spacebar to preview the video, it'll start pre-rendering and it'll play the clip when the pre-rendering is done. Oftentimes when I make longer and more complicated videos, the pre-rendering will take a while, and I don't want to wait for maybe the whole 4-minute video to be pre-rendered, I just want to watch a couple seconds. So in that case, if I just hit spacebar again, it'll automatically play it for me. So it looks like our clip has already pre-rendered, so we'll be able to hit space and just watch it. And we will see that we now have an animation of the character moving up onto the screen over 4 seconds. So I recommend playing around with the basic transform settings and getting comfortable with making and navigating around keyframes as well, as this will be the foundation of basically all motion graphics. So now let's try adding one more animation. Let's make the character fade in for 2 seconds as well. So I'm going to hit T to open up the opacity property, hit this stopwatch to make a keyframe. I'm going to set the opacity to 0, and now I'll move my timeline marker to 2 seconds and drag it all the way up to 100. And now we have this little fade-in animation. Let's see, I need to pre-render this. There we go. So now if I want to go back and edit my position keyframes, let's say I want it to fade and slide onto the screen at the same time. Right now they're a little bit different. Instead of hitting P to open up the position property, I can actually hit the U key now. And what this does is that it'll open up all properties that are currently being animated, so I can view both of them at the same time. So now with this, I can move our position back to 2 seconds. And now it fades and slides onto the screen. There are a couple more important hotkeys I'd like to cover. So if you want to shorten the length of a layer, one option is to go to the end. So I can zoom out here, and then I can go to the end and then drag this all the way to the length that I want it to be. Although this can be a little bit tedious at times. So what you can actually do is use the hotkey Alt and then right bracket. And this will automatically cut the length of the file to be where your current time point is. And if you want to adjust the beginning, you can do Alt and then left bracket. So you'd be using these quite a lot to adjust the length of your layers. Alternatively, if you want to move your layers around, so let's say I want this not to start at 0 seconds, but I want it to start at 2, one option is to just drag it, or you can just hit left bracket and it'll directly jump the file. If I want it to end at a specific place, like 5 seconds, I can go to 5 seconds and hit right bracket and it'll automatically move it there. Alternatively, if I want to move my time point marker and not the file itself, I can hit I and this will automatically jump me to the beginning of the file that we're currently selecting. And I can also hit O and that will jump us to the end. So these will be quite convenient for moving around so that you don't need to like zoom in all the way here to move it to the exact frame that you would like. So I'm just gonna zoom in and set this back to the beginning. So we have our zoom animation. Not our zoom animation, our moving up sliding animation. Okay, so lastly, you'll notice that in the bottom left corner of this preview box, there is a selection for resolution. So when you have a lot of layers in After Effects, it gets quite slow to pre-render and view your video. This one is really fast and easy because it's only one file, but sometimes it will really often take me minutes or tens of minutes on end to pre-render something. So it gets quite slow if you always want to constantly view it in full high quality. So typically I like to work on quarter resolution, and this will render every fourth pixel or so, which is why we get this pixelated image. And then I only swap to half or full if I'm either one working on a really simple video like this, and then it's pretty fast to pre-render, or I know for some people who have faster computers, they like to work in half or third. I recommend just choosing whatever resolution is the best balance for you between not looking at a pile of pixels and being able to view your video quickly. So that's going to be all for this video, and I'll catch you in the next one. If you like this video, please make sure to subscribe to the channel and also like the video. And in the comments, please let me know if there are any specific topics you'd like me to cover in the future, or if you just found this video helpful for you. Thank you!